Well, we're still working on procedures and air conditionings and everything else, and we'll get there. And trying to work out the kinks, and thought we had a day off yesterday. And then it was rush, trying to get the building cleaned out from water. And I was thinking to myself as I was utilizing a push broom, pushing waves of water out of the building, kind of reminds me of growing up on the coast and dealing with hurricanes. And so, glad Bema was around. That was his wife playing the piano, and able to get things squared away. I want to really kind of begin a series, even though we'll be doing communion today, because in the midst of the verses that I read a while ago, the Bible makes it very clear in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 that before we take of the Lord's table, there is a degree of seriousness and even somberness that is brought to the occasion. Now, the Bible says as we do this, what we in verse 24 and 25, we remember. But also at the same time, at the end of verse 26, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. He died, but he doesn't remain dead. He rose from the grave. And so the Bible lets us know that we remember what has been accomplished at the cross, and at the same time, we are to celebrate in anticipation what is to come, and we still do that. But yet, at the same time, when we come, there is a degree of somberness that is brought to this event that's unlike anything else that you'll find in Scripture. And you say, now, what do you mean by that? Well, the Bible says that before we partake of the Lord's table, then we are to judge ourselves. And we are to look at ourselves, and we do so in light of the Word of God. So when it says that we are to judge ourselves, and it is very clear as we examine ourselves in verse 28, we examine ourselves in light of Scripture. We don't examine ourselves in light of the culture. We don't examine ourselves based on what everybody else is doing. We don't examine ourselves based on what the most recent opinion polls say. We examine ourselves in light of revealed truth, which is the Word of God. And remember in John 17, 17, Jesus says, sanctify them in truth. That's Jesus praying to the Father. And then he says, thy word is truth. So there is to be a degree of somberness, of seriousness as we come together and we participate in communion and the Lord's table. But I believe that most often we fail to realize how important it is to judge ourselves, to examine ourselves, not based on how I feel, not based on what I think, but it is to be based on the Word of God. Now, again, as I mentioned to you, I was thinking about this, and some of you, maybe most all of you, have had an opportunity to go to Washington, D.C., and go to Arlington National Cemetery, and go to the tomb of the unknown soldier, and the changing of the guard. And they are very particular about what goes on while the guard is being changed. Things may have changed, I don't know, but I know that when I experienced it, they're not having anybody cutting up, laughing and telling jokes and making a bunch of racket and breaking ranks, if you would. I mean, they have a parameter that is very clear. You don't go past this. And if you get loud, they'll ask you to leave or they'll help you find your way out. And so there's a degree of somberness that is there at the tomb of the unknown soldier and the exchange of the guard. Now, we grasp that and we understand that. And we can go and we can participate and we can be somber and serious about what takes place. But what about What about the person that was not only in the military, but was in combat? What about the person who was in combat and some of his fellow soldiers that he bunked with, ate with, went through training with? They didn't come back. All of a sudden now, the seriousness and the somberness of the event and all it signifies around the tomb of the unknown soldier goes far beyond anyone who's just there watching the ceremony, maybe participating in the ceremony, and we grasp and understand to a degree, but will never grasp and understand to the degree that the person who has been in combat and maybe had his best friend's body parts splattered upon him. I mean, it's things we can't even fathom. There are a lot of people that participate in the Lord's table. Maybe even been in the, we say like in the military, they're a Christian. They're Christians. But they're not really grasping. They're not really biblically looking at, perceiving what it took to buy your pardon, to pay your penalty for your sin, to wipe away your blood guiltiness, to justify, to sanctify, and one day glorify. This occasion that we are going to be participating in. Now, why is it that somebody would not be willing to examine themselves correctly, properly, justly? Is it that we've gotten so accustomed to making excuses, justifying, and comparing ourselves not in light of Scripture, not in light of our own lovely Lord Jesus Christ, whereby the standard is very clear? Both John and Peter make it very clear in their writings, we're to be holy even as he is holy. 1 John chapter 3 says, and everyone who has his hope fixed on him purifies himself even as he is pure. So is it that we're just not willing to look and see what Scripture clearly states and says without any equivocation? And so we just sort of glibly participate. But to do so is to treat lightly the blood of Christ. It is, as the Bible talks about in Hebrews, about trampling underfoot the blood of Christ. Can you? I mean, lost people participate? And the answer is, yeah, they participate. But what about Christians that are unwilling to look at themselves correctly in lieu of, in light of, the Word of God? It's a wonderful time for grace in the life of the believer. Now, we don't dispense grace. That's not even it. But this is a wonderful time before we participate in the Lord's Supper to examine ourselves, to look at ourselves, to be able to say before God, oh God, is there any harmful way? Kind of reminds you of an Old Testament scripture, doesn't it? Oh God, is there something in my life that I don't see? Oh God, is there something in my life that I'm living with, I'm not willing to deal with? Oh God, is there something in my life that is not reflective of your goodness and your glory? Show it that I may confess and repent of that. He says we are to examine ourselves. Let me just give a word of caution here. It's easy sometimes for us to look at other people. But I want to remind you of what the Bible talks about, what Jesus talks about in Matthew. We need to take care of the beam in our own eye before we worry about the speck in somebody else's eyes. And so it's self-examination. It's not cross-examination to any member of your family or any other member of this church. It's self-examination. Because when everything is said and done, it's just you and God. Is that correct? It's just you and the Lord. And so we are to examine ourselves, but again, we do so in light of the Word of God. Now, I want to preach probably a series of messages, and I'm not sure, it may be two, maybe four. You know how that goes with me. But why is it that a person would eat and drink in an unworthy manner? Can I just say to you, it's deception. And further, it is self-deception. Now, we're in 1 Corinthians, and if you know anything about the Bible, 1 Corinthians is not a letter commending the church. It's a letter condemning the church. It's a corrective letter. And Paul is pointing out all the things that's wrong in the Corinthian church, and it's things with which they have written to him about. I mean, for instance, in chapter 5, you got a man living with his father's wife. And, you know, you can look at that and say what you want to, but Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that even the Gentiles, even the unbelieving community, know that it's not right for a man to be living with his stepmother and his father and stepmother aren't even divorced, but they're taken up together. That's just wrong. And any way you want to look at it, and the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, flee immorality. So you're dealing a lot with sexual sin in the life of Corinth. But yet we're living in a time frame in which sexual immorality is not just being tolerated, it's being pushed, and not just pushed upon adults, but the youngest of our society. Little boys and girls having to cope with and deal with this. Well, maybe you're not in the right body and all that kind of foolishness, which God is very clear. But the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. It has ramifications, it has long-term, long-lasting impacts into the life of the person who is immoral. It has to do with our thinking, it has to do with our being. But again, I'm amazed at how many people, they don't think anything about being involved sexually before they're married, outside of marriage. And we have today a whole proliferation of people that think, you know, marriage is a bygone institution. It is a bygone institution in a sense it goes way back, but it's not gone. And it is an institution that the Lord has given to us from the very beginning, Adam and Eve. And anything outside of that when it comes to physical involvement is immorality. And if it involves one party or the other that's married, it's called adultery. And we can say what we want to, and we can dress this stuff up any way you want to. But God's word is very clear. And it is a deceiving thing to think that one can saunter in and participate with the Lord's table and just meander right on back out and continue in pornography. Oh, we make it sound okay, you know, and extramarital affairs. No, God's got another word for it. It's called adultery. And we can clean it up, dress it up, and put some different words to it, but it all comes out to be the very same thing. Now, we are living in a pornographic society today. And if you're a Christian, you understand it is a battle. It is a war. And one of the greatest blessings of the day that one dies is that the struggle is what? Because how often are we supposed to take up our cross and follow Jesus? Once a week? Once a month? No, daily. Because it's a daily struggle. I've said this before. You know, the Bible says you got to be willing to take up your cross daily and follow him. And I may have done real good yesterday, but I can tell you right now, this body doesn't want to get back over the cross today. It's a battle, and it's continuous. But like good soldiers, we are not to allow ourselves to become entangled into the everyday affairs of life. Being deceived, is it an issue today? Absolutely. What's the standard whereby we look at ourselves? Do we compare ourselves with what we see in the headlines of the news? Do we compare ourselves with the neighborhood? Do we compare ourselves with the state? Do we compare ourselves with the West Coast, the left coast, the right? I don't know what you want to call it. But the comparison is none of those, is it? And it's not what's allowed in the school system or the private school. It's not what's allowed in somebody else's household. It's what does the Word of God have to say. Nothing else matters. Matter of fact, Peter says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of our Lord, what? Endures forever. And we're in 1 Corinthians, and right here in the midst of having the Lord's table, and he talks about husband-wife relationships in chapter 7. But there's a verse. Now, there's a well-known preacher talks about this is a kind of a club verse to beat people over the head with. No, it's just a truth verse. You understand that? It's just a truth verse. And the Word of God is truth. Now, we can pull out verses, but it didn't make any difference if something is stated. We looked at this in our men's Bible study the other night. But if there's something that's stated 42 times or one time, it's still the Word of God. We don't put it on the scales and weigh it out. But I want you to look in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're talking about self-deception. Now, most of us in here can feel good looking at ourselves in light of this verse. But the Bible makes it very clear that we're not to be deceived. Now, you've got this right here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. Don't be deceived. You'll find this very same word back over in chapter 15 and verse 33. Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. So here we are. Now, we're in chapter 11, kind of in the middle between 6 and 15. But yet the Bible says here in chapter 6 and verse 9, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Yeah, it just seems so redundant to have to say that the unrighteous aren't going to heaven. And so all you got to do is go back and read 1 John. It's not a long letter. Just read 1 John. And anybody that claims to be of God and they're unrighteous, God says through the Apostle John in 1 John that that person is a liar and the truth is not in him. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Now, if you're righteous, it's not because you're a do-gooder or, you know, whatever. Because the Bible makes it very clear, you don't have anything to offer. But it also says, the last verse of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, that he made him who knew no sin to be sin in our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So if you have righteousness, it is an imputed righteousness, the very righteousness that belongs to Christ himself. But the unrighteous will not go to heaven. I don't know any other, how plainer you could make that sound. Then he says this, verse 9, do not be deceived. Now again, it's okay. Neither fornicators. Do I even need to explain that? If you are involved in any way, shape, fashion, or form sexually outside of a marriage, that's you. Now, somebody may ask the question, you mean if I kind of let my feelings and passions get away with me and I commit this, that means I'm not a Christian? No. You see, this is in what would be known as the present ongoing tense, that is denoting continuous action, unabated. If that's your lifestyle, if that describes who you are, don't be deceived in thinking you're going to heaven, because your lifestyle reveals who you really are. Now, it's not by works of righteousness that we have done, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. And the Bible says we are His workmanship in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10. We are His workmanship, and we are created unto good deeds. Now, our life, our works, our deeds reveal who we are. Now, I want to say this one more time. You don't work in order to become. No, reality is, because I have become, I work. God changes our hearts. He gives us a new heart. He changes our want-tos, and He changes who we are. And He does it from where? The inside out. That's what He does. Now, you understand, verse 9, those who are involved sexually outside of the bond of marriage, they're not going. Idolaters. You know, the Bible says in the epistles that greed is as the sin of idolatry. Greed. I can't tell you how many times I've heard as a pastor, even being here for the 30 years that I've been here, people talk about, you know, they're over here and they over here and they're doing this and pursuing this and doing, I just don't have time. Well, you've made it very clear what your idol is. It is, you know, your idol is not God. You've got somebody else and something else in place of God. You're substituting. You're an idolater. I understand you don't have a statue of Buddha on the shelf at your house that you're bowing down and burning incense to. You just don't have time for God. But we make time for what we love, do we not? Sure we do. Idolaters. And then here's adulterers. And I already explained what adulterers is. I don't think it needs explanation. Nor effeminate. And what is that? That is the passive person in a homosexual relationship. Nor homosexuals. Nor thieves. If you are a thief, you're not going to heaven. If that describes who you are, you may be bringing home paper clips from work, pens from work, or you may be embezzling. I don't know. You may be stealing somebody else's ideas and passing them on as your own. You may be copying somebody else's homework on a regular routine basis and putting your name on it and turning it in. That's a thief. If that's your lifestyle, nor the covetous. You just green with envy. It just gets all over you that somebody else, you go to the class reunion and somebody else has made so much better than you. Somebody is doing so much better. You're jealous of somebody else's family, home life, the neighborhood they live in, the clothes, the places they go. You just add nausea. You're covetous. Yeah, there's no contentedness. Philippians 4 addresses that. He says they're drunkards. Again, this could be anything that takes away sobriety. Drugs, alcohol. They just, you know, over-the-counter pills. Whatever you want to fill in the blank. Then it says, nor revilers. You know, I cut up a little bit with people because I have to be somewhat careful because I can come back real quick with a retort. I really can. And I say this occasionally. Can you imagine what an unredeemed Glenn would sound like? But a reviler. I heard that, Brian. Brian says, So, but a reviler is somebody that destroys another person with their mouth. Sometimes it can be the spouse. Sometimes it can be your children. Sometimes it can be a coworker, somebody at the drive-up line. Or somebody that crosses your path on Facebook and you don't like what they say.
swindlers, always taking advantage of somebody. And just in case you didn't get it in verse 9, he says it again at the end of verse 10, they're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. And then verse 11, and such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified. That's just another way of saying you got saved. That's just another way of saying you've been redeemed, regenerated. You've been born again. You now have, as your Father, no longer the devil, but God the Father. There's been a change in your life. Now, it doesn't mean that some of these things aren't residual and some of these things you no longer have to deal with. But you have the power in the Holy Spirit who lives within you to have victory over these things. You don't live enslaved. Matter of fact, in Romans chapter 6, the Bible says that before you were saved, you were a slave to unrighteousness. But now that you have been saved, you are enslaved to God. Doesn't mean I've lost my capacity to sin. And if you want to know about that, you can ask my wife. Preferably don't. But I've not lost my capacity to sin. But the continuing that sin unabated is no longer there. And Bible makes it very clear. So we're talking about, and such were some of you. Listen to this. Now let's turn to 1 Corinthians 15:33. Now it says in verse 9 there, don't be deceived. 1 Corinthians 15:33. The Bible says, do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Here's that word there again about being deceived. And but the word corrupt there, the word corrupt really means to bring about an end that is devastating, that is ruined completely and totally. The word corrupt comes from a Greek word that means to cause someone to become perverse or depraved as a type of moral destruction. It means to deprave, to pervert, to ruin, to cause the moral ruin of. Bad company will pull one. And let's just go ahead and say it like this. Some of you've got your favorite old movies, and Margaret and I were, I think, newlyweds when the first Star Wars came out. Has anybody ever seen any of the Star Wars movies? Well, I see most of you have. And then there was a particular individual in there named Darth. And Darth Vader succumbed to the what? Dark side. And there was a constant throughout. I never watched all of them. I kind of got tired after the first 15 years, you know. And so, but they kept making them and making them because they made money. But anyway, but the whole thing was they kept trying to pull Luke over to the dark side, didn't they? Because Darth got pulled over to the dark side. Do you understand when it says bad company corrupts? It's not just that you're going to get a little rust on your favorite knife. It doesn't mean that you're going to get a little mud on something. No, the corruption here is an absolute corruption that they will pull you into a thinking, a belief, an activity. Listen to this, that is totally corrupt, and I'll just say it a little different way. That damns. And there is no recovery from that. And so it may be somebody says it nice, they seem nice, they could be religious leaders, and there is a proliferation of religious leaders that do just that today. As a matter of fact, you know, I'm amazed sometimes at what I hear and what I see from people that ought to know better. Because if anybody just opens their Bible and reads the Word of God, they would know. For instance, in Romans chapter 1, now listen to what it says. I want to read beginning of verse 28. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind to do those things which are not proper. And he just got finished telling us what those things were. And it's homosexuality. It's right there in the previous verses. But listen to what it says. Being filled with all unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, evil, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malice. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, arrogant, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding, untrustworthy, unloving, unmerciful. And although they know the ordinance of God, what does that mean? They know what the Bible says. They know what the Bible teaches. Although they know the ordinance of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death. That is, if they continue in that, all they have to look forward to is damnation, perdition. But it says here at the end of verse 32, they not only do the same thing, but they also give hearty approval to those who practice them. You mean to tell me that there are those who are religious leaders that will give a false reading, a false gospel? I mean, it says in 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, that they come and somebody preaches another Jesus. I want you to watch this for a moment. It's a couple of minutes, but watch this. Well,
e la capacità del dialogo interreligioso.
One of the things that struck me about all of you here is your ability to engage in interreligious dialogue.
E questo è molto importante.
And this is very important.
Perché se voi incominciate a litigare, la mia religione è più importante della tua, la mia è la vera, la tua non è vera, dove ci porta questo?
Because if we start to fight amongst ourselves and saying, my religion is more important than yours, my religion is true, yours is not, where will that lead us?
Dove?
Where will it lead us?
Qualcuno risponda, dove?
Someone respond, where would it lead us?
Forte.
La distruzione.
E cosa così? E ci vuole litigare.
Yes, it's okay to discuss and to...
Tutte le religioni... È una delle cose che più mi ha colpito di voi giovani, di questi qui, no? È la capacità del dialogo interreligioso. È una delle cose che più mi ha colpito di voi giovani, di questi qui, no? È la capacità del dialogo interreligioso.
One of the things that struck me about all of you here is your ability to engage in interreligious dialogue.
E questo è molto importante.
And this is very important.
Perché se voi incominciate a litigare, la mia religione è più importante della tua, la mia è la vera, la tua non è vera, dove ci porta questo?
Because if we start to fight amongst ourselves and saying, my religion is more important than yours, my religion is true, yours is not, where will that lead us?
Dove?
Where will it lead us?
Qualcuno risponda, dove?
Someone respond, where would it lead us?
La distruzione.
E cosa così? E ci vuole litigare.
Yes, it's okay to discuss and to...
Tutte le religioni sono un cammino per arrivare a Dio.
Because every religion is a way to arrive at God.
Sono, dirò una comparazione, sono come diverse lingue, diversi idiomi per arrivare lì.
Sort of a comparison, an example would be they're sort of like different languages in order to arrive at God.
Ma Dio è Dio per tutti.
But God is God for all.
E come Dio è Dio per tutti, noi siamo tutti figli di Dio.
And if God is God for all, then we're all sons and daughters of God.
Ma il mio Dio è più importante del tuo.
But my God is more important than your God.
È vero quello?
Is that true?
C'è un solo Dio lì. E noi sono idiomi, cammino, lingue per arrivare a Dio.
There's only one God, and each of us is a language, so to speak, in order to arrive at God.
Qualcuno è schi, qualcuno musulmano, qualcuno indi, qualcuno cristiano, ma sono diversi cammini.
They're different paths.
Understood?
All right. That sounds nice. And people like to hear that. But nothing could be further from the revealed truth of the Word of God. He's addressing Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, those who hold to animism. What does that do to all the missionaries of years gone by? But that is a lie. And I would make it very clear, Jesus had dialogue with scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees. And in John 8, beginning in verse 44, he says, they are of their father, the devil. You got to understand what is being proliferated in our world out there. How many ways to heaven, to salvation, how is there? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. But yet we have a world of people that will listen to this and will accept it, and they will be a part of the group in Matthew 7 that Jesus says will say to him in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonderful deeds in your name? And then the Lord says, I will say to them in that day, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, for I never knew you. Now, what you heard there would be described by an observer who is not a believer as love speech. That same observer would look and listen to what I'm saying from the Bible, and they would say, that's hate speech. Love speech, according to the world, lulls people to damnation with no hope. No, true love speech says, here's the cure, the only cure, and the cure is none other than Jesus and Jesus alone. If all of us are climbing the same hillside and all of us are going to come up at the pinnacle point together and we're just all going to have a good time by and by, why did Jesus come? Why did the Father place upon him if there are other ways and means? Friend, that's deception. Now again, I'm going to be speaking about deception. The Bible in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. Again, the word corrupt there has to do with utter corruption, utter ruin. Not just a little tainting, not just a little bit of rust, not just taking a little bit of luster off of the finish. We're talking about complete and total corruption. The word means to mislead people as to proper views, which they should have, and may often be expressed idiomatically, according to one Greek lexicon. For example, it means to twist people's thoughts. You ever heard somebody in a dialogue say, they've just got me all twisted. I didn't know what was what.
I meant to pick this one, but I ended up picking that one. I don't even know why. I got all twisted. It had me twisted. And to cause what is false to seem like what is true. To make a lie appear true. To dig away the truth. Or to cover the eyes with lies. It means simply to go astray. Isaiah in chapter 5 talks about those who substitute bitter for sweet. You know, what is right is substituted for what is wrong. And the Lord even says later on in Isaiah and Jeremiah, he makes a statement, he says, and my people love it so. So we're going to participate in the Lord's table. Now, you can deal with sin in your life before God in light of the Word of God. Maybe you like to gossip. Maybe you have bitter and anger, jealousy. Maybe you are a reviler. Maybe you are the person nobody else may know, but you're involved sexually outside of marriage. You can participate. I may never know, but I'm going to tell you something. There is one who is omniscient, and God does know. You know, it's interesting. I was reading that just this past week over in the Old Testament in Psalms. It talks about the people grumbled and the Lord heard it. I can remember reading that verse and thinking to myself, but it says they grumbled in their tents. They didn't do it where everybody else heard them. They didn't do it where anybody else heard them. They grumbled against the Lord in their tents. Privately. We forget. God isn't just in this building. He's here because we're here. But God is omnipresent. He's everywhere, all the time. I'm telling y'all, and you've heard me say this, I grew up next door to a mamaw. And I remember mamaw telling me, Autry, you be careful. Because wherever you go, whatever you do, you remember, the Lord sees. Well, I don't know about the rest of y'all, but that's a pretty fair deterrent to a lot of things. And somebody says, well, I understood you got into a lot of trouble. I did. I didn't get saved till I was 19. But I, like I said a while ago, I can't even begin to fathom what it would have been like in this time frame outside of a family that did not care. But the Bible is very clear. We're going to participate in the Lord's table. You are invited to participate. But I just want to say, let us do so properly before God and examining our hearts before Him. Now, what we're going to do, we are going to have a time of invitation. That is, maybe you've been saved, but yet you've never made it public. You want to make public today your faith and trust in Christ. We're going to invite you to come. Maybe it is you are one, like so many of us along through life's journey, have strayed a little bit. And according to Revelation chapter 2, as John writes to the church at Ephesus, he says, I've got this against you. You've left your first love. What you need to do is repent, remember, and you need to do again the works you did at first. He's just calling you back. Baptists used to use the word, you're backslidden. Well, what you need to do is just simply return to your first love. Maybe God is calling you to be a part of this church family, to officially join with us and be a member here, helping us in reaching those around us with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Maybe you just need to come and pray at the altar and go back. Maybe you just need to, during this time frame, just you and God, just to deal with some things in your life, so that when you partake of the communion in a little bit, you're clean. Wonderful time to be able to be clean before God. Let's stand together, and I'm going to pray, and I'm going to ask if you keep your heads and eyes, heads bowed and eyes shut as Jeremy sings our song of commitment. Father, in Jesus' name, we simply pray that you would have your way with us as we have these moments of commitment. Now, with our heads bowed, eyes closed, you deal with you, your sin, your place. And if you need to come this morning, this is the time we'd invite you to come as Brother Jeremy sings. Presence here today, for those who have come to the altar to pray. Father, we're thankful for salvation we have in Christ, who is our great warrior. And we rejoice today that there is no tomb for our great warrior, but you arose from the grave. But as we participate in communion here, we pray, Lord, you'll bless our time together. And may our Lord and Savior be exalted in our midst. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. As the guys come forward. This is a little different than what we have been doing. So bear with us and we will proceed. Thank you.
we come in a time of remembering, even going back to the Gospels and seeing what you endured, righteous, eternal God, and the second person, Emmanuel, God with us. What you suffered physically was most horrendous. But to have the sin debt of all who would ever believe placed upon you, and there be separation within the triune Godhead, you did for the believer. So we come and we remember today. We thank you and we rejoice in salvation we have in Jesus. Amen. The Bible says, when he had broken and given to his disciples, he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." I didn't know they were coming back, so. The Bible says, in the same way he took the cup. Let's pray. Father, again, your blood, symbolic of your life, your sacrifice as the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Your sacrifice in behalf of the sinner. You made him who knew no sin to be sin in our behalf, that we literally would become the righteousness of God. We rejoice, we remember, and we celebrate the time to come when we will see you face to face in glory. Bless our time as we partake. Amen. It is good to see you today. Keep your cups. There are garbage cans out there, and that would be very good. Good to have guests with us today. We do have a welcome center out here. Some of our staff will be there. Be happy to answer any questions you may have. Again, thank you for being here today. Just invite somebody to come next week. Most people will come because somebody like you invited them. And again, I want to say a word of appreciation to all those who have worked for us to get up here, and then they came back. And even Beetle Bailey was vacuuming yesterday with his shop vac. And so, appreciate it allowing us to have service today. Good to see you. Let's stand and we'll have our parting chorus. Brother Jeremy.
Bless you. Have a great afternoon.